In heaven, indeed, we are so grateful that among the many places that we can appear being a Sunday morning is in a place of worship. For this is a declaration each one of us we made when we became Christians. We thank you, mighty Father, that you have continually honored the Sabbath principle, that we work and on seventh day we come to give thanks. We thank you because one of the essence and the purpose of a Sunday service is to celebrate your goodness upon our lives. We thank you that we are able to make it and we are not ignorant of what is happening or what some people are going through, but for us we are the remnants. Receive our thanks. Have your ways all round and minister to us through your word. For this we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you very much for finding time and Sunday service remaining very significant to you, that you spare and come and be with others. The Sabbath principle is left to the individuals, because there are some people Sunday is not a big deal, but for us it has remained to be fashionable that we come and worship with other people, and we really appreciate. And as I share the word, it's also good to do some housekeeping. One, we appreciate that guest, that brother who came to worship with us. We don't take it for granted because there are many places, there are many churches around. But you became so intentional to come and worship with us. God bless and keep you well. Number two, it's good to ask your neighbor whether he has registered the SIM card. His SIM number. Whether he has registered to avoid giving us a problem when we need to get hold of you. Because you know Kenyans are very peculiar. The last hour. Are you sure your neighbor has registered? Or that's not none of your business? You know somebody can tell for what purpose? But we need you. We need to be connected. The connectivity is very critical. It's good to do things when they are needed to be done. We are in the Lent period. And we have continued to share in our bulletin the message of the rent period. And the week that we are approaching is a very important week for us as Christians. If there is a holiday or a moment set aside in the calendar that's so significant to the life of a believer, is the rent period. And especially the week that we are approaching today is what we call the triumphal entry. When our Master Jesus Christ entered Jerusalem, there was a prophecy that the king is coming to deliver the whole city of Jerusalem. Although there was some misconception among them, because they didn't know exactly the kind of the king they were waiting and looking forward to come in. And therefore, as a way to connect with our sermon today, whereby we are talking, thanksgiving is the key to multiplication, because that's our theme, it's good to understand this week. And especially from today, and the climax will be on Sunday. And as a result of that Sunday climax, the risen Christ, a day set aside the following day, the one that we call the Easter Monday. And there are things that we need to know. Why do we call it Holy Week? As a Christian, we should connect and engage well the week that is ahead of us. I know some of you still be on duty. Others, we have to travel because we have set aside from Friday to Monday is a public holiday, we can say so. When Jesus Christ time came for him to enter to Jerusalem, as it was prophesied, and to them, when they heard his coming and the kind of the life that were going through, the whole city had to wake up and meet the king that is coming, because he was being revealed to be the King of Kings. But Jesus, his entry to Jerusalem came very different to their expectations, because before he entered, he sent his disciples, go to that home. Among the many homes that were there, we don't know the criteria that he used, and the donkey was a very common animal then. And he said, go to that home and untie that donkey. And in the eventuality, the owner asked, what is this that is happening? Let that owner know that the master needed. I don't know whether they had any struggle to get it, but you can imagine somebody you have no arrangement is sending for your matatu or your vehicle to be taken for his use. And Jesus sat on that donkey, entered to Jerusalem. And because they were so expectant, they were so hopeful, and especially hearing the kings of kings, to them, some of them, they could have expected he came riding on a horse, because that one reflects a king and a battle and a deliverance. But he came riding on a donkey, and he was received with all the manner of joy. And to them in Jerusalem, the best thing that they could have done to lay a red carpet to him was the palm, because it was a common vegetation in that land, so that he may lie down these to receive him. And like today, very important people, what we usually do is the red carpet. For them, because of the expectation and what they were going through, and they were hearing of the master, the king of the kings who will come, will bring the deliverance, that's the best they could have done. And here we ask ourselves, what do you do to that very important guest, the King of the King, your Savior? How do you really receive him in your heart? To them, physically, this is what they did. But Christ Jesus, he never came like the kings to rule the world, but he was coming as a King of Kings to deliver the people. And that's a great lesson among us as Christians. What is that very important thing that you do to acknowledge and to recognize Christ to be your Savior and Christ to be the one to occupy the preeminence position in your heart? Then on Monday, when Jesus entered to Jerusalem on a donkey, he was not putting up, he was not spending the night at Jerusalem. He was spending in a city, on a town called Bethany, which was about 7 miles away from Jerusalem. And that's where he was spending during this week, so that you may connect well with the Holy Week. To them that have gone to Jerusalem, Jerusalem is surrounded by the mountain, and the city is down there. And we are being told that Jesus Christ, because he had come for a divine mission, on Monday, after spending the night at Bethany, we are told by the scriptures and the history, he came to Jerusalem with his disciples. And Jesus Christ, because he was human and also divine, he had a need to eat. He had a need to fulfill. And we are being told he found a tree on the road, and a mighty one that looked very green. And he desired to have something to eat. and to his disappointment, that this tree, the so-called the sycamore tree, the mokoyo tree, had nothing. Mighty and powerful, strategically along the roadside. And there and there, we are being told he cursed the tree. And it started to dry up. And even the devil wondered, what is this? Have you done? Christ Jesus was not impressed by that tree. Along, broken even other trees to not grow well. Yet there is nothing. And it was cursed. And I'm telling you today, if there is one tree that is known that bear a lot of fruits, even where others they don't bear, don't do. Mokoyo siara gina ko kinya chege kini. No ni mumbe. Kumrudi angwe woko. Is there anybody who consume goyo? Even some of you may wonder what is this tree that I'm talking about. But remember, during the appointed time, there was nothing. And that mokoyo tree was cursed and started to dry. And one of the great lessons that we learn, there is what people expect of you, but it's a total disappointment. We are parents, we bring forth our children, and I'm telling you there are some expectations, only to get a raw deal. You are a boss, you are an employee, there are some expectations, and where you are, but there is nothing. And there, sycamore tree was cursed. And it's a great lesson during this time. What are your deliverables? Where you are, do you deliver? God has put you in that family to be the mother of the family. Hapo ni kwako, and that is your territory. But do you deliver? You're the head of this family. God has put you there. Are you really doing what is expected of you at the right time? The sycamore tree was cursed. That's what happened. Within the week, at one time in the evening, Jesus Christ in Bethany, we are being told because there was a prophecy, he will go through some challenges. And it was the habit and the tradition and the practice of the people there to anoint somebody who is sick or on the verge of death. A certain lady called Mary. The only thing that she felt she could give Jesus was perfume. Very expensive perfume. And she went to anoint Jesus. And when this lady was busy anointing Jesus, some guys were talking. This lady must be very extravagant. What should this do the, all this? To them, they started to convert the kind of the anointing oil that she had. They were seeing the money. And even it was heard from some of the disciples saying, "Hii mafuta ikeuzwa," and the poor people be given. Only Jesus to turn to the disciples and told them, "You have the poor people all the time, but for me, I'm here for a given time." Then this lady, she offered the best that she had. She anointed Jesus, and she felt this is the way. And I'm telling you, it was also a practice in that community. But during this very important, noble exercise, she was challenged on the game. And she was called names. And a great lesson that we learn. Do you think an approval and an affirmation anything time you do something? You can hear some comments. Choir members, you may sing and you came for the practice. Only when you are done, we ask ourselves, surely, are these people serious? Are you serious? And if you are there to get the approval from the people, you get disappointed. As a reader, you may think you have done the best, only to hear some comments. This lady, she gave the best that she had, only to be told she is extravagant, and this oil could have been sold, and the poor people be given. Please stick to your reign. Don't mess up with the reign of other people. Let them do. This lady, she never consulted anybody. She decided to do on her own. I'm telling you, even when you are on your lane, you still hear some voices. Mind about your own business. And then Jesus Christ said, what this lady she has done, it will be known forever and ever. That little that the Lord may tell you to do, do it without waiting any approval or affirmation, because you'll be discouraged. That's a great lesson that we learn during this week. This week, give the best that you can. We have been told on last day, on the eve of the Friday, the Good Friday, the one that we call the Good Friday, Jesus Christ called upon his disciples and he tell them, let's go in a certain garden called Gethsemane and we go to worship together. And we are being told when they went there to pray, within all time, the guys were asleep. Yet, Christ Jesus here had a mission with them to go and pray. And I'm telling you, looking around, Mary going, all the Mary thought. And he had gone purposely to go to pray. And he challenged them. Because Jesus wanted to generate the power to go through what was ahead of him. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, prayer is a work. Tell your neighbor, prayer is a work. It's not a walk in the park. It's not a, because you have to be deliberate. You have to be intentional. That's why some people go to an extent of even fasting. Prayer is a work. The disciples were found asleep. At the nick of the time when they were supposed to be the master. This week, the whole week, what happened on that Thursday, remember when he was still with his disciples, he was to preside over the last meal with them. Because to him, he knew what was waiting upon him. And I'm telling you, the betrayal of the highest order, one of the disciples had already struck a deal to sold the master. And he came in a manner that you could not expect. Because he had told the enemies, the one that I will do what? The one that I will, whatever you call it, is the one. Is the one. The one that I will do A, B, C, D is the one. And Christ Jesus was taken. And they had even organized the same night, there will be a kind of ruling to be done. And it took the whole night. The whole night on Thursday, he has been betrayed by the one in the inner circle. Tell your neighbor, inner circle. The inner circle, the one, the inner space. And then the whole thing, proceedings went on throughout the night. And one of the disciples decided to withdraw, but listening from far. And he was beside the fireplace. There was a fire somewhere. And a certain girl, because it was an issue that was open for everybody, a certain girl saw one of the disciples seated around the fire. And just tell your neighbor, a girl, just a girl. Just a girl. And the guy was approached and asked, but you look like the one who is appearing there, look like you are a friend and you have been seen together. The guy said, Haki ya Mungu, kamwe, I don't know him. And he did it 3 times. I swear, Haki ya Mungu, gayomwe. And there, he denied it. Yet remember, he was the spokesman to the group. Remember, he is one of them who was appointed, and he is the one even later to be called the rock. He really, he threw the tantrums, and he said, I have never even have no business with him. the place Jesus was taken. Only to find ourselves on Good Friday, the one that we call the Good Friday, 2,000 years ago was a terrible Friday to our master. We call it Good Friday because the outcome is what we enjoy. But that night, it was terrible. And we see Christ Jesus. Those who have gone to Israel, there's a way to cross before he was taken to the Golgotha. And in fact, we are praying hand. You know, for a Muslim, the typical Muslim, before, during one's lifetime, you have to go to Mecca to see their origin. We are looking forward and we are trying to campaign for this. As a Christian, because what we read in the Bible, you need to know the Bible land, the land Bible, the Bible land where it was written. There is the need for one, and especially anytime here, there is a pilgrim to Israel, to pray God's hand that you may also go there and see some of the things that you read in the Bible. And here, Christ was crucified. On Saturday, there's nothing. He was in the graveyard. And on Sunday, brothers and sisters, we are coming to celebrate of his resurrection. And you remember our Christ Jesus, though the Son of God, even he had nowhere to be buried. They had to borrow a graveyard for somebody, and he was kept there. And when they know they have conquered, only Christ Jesus to resurrect, because he was the Son of God, and he was in a mission that was called. So the whole week is with us. When we reflect, Holy Week, the Easter period is not even marked by the public speech. We don't have the presidential speech around this time, or the governors. It's the time for me and for you to reflect on that. And that's why we are here, just to give thanks. Last week was a day set aside for Thanksgiving. And I'm telling you, if there's one area that we should do even on our knees, is when it comes to Thanksgiving. And especially when we think about the salvation, when we think about our faith, it costed God to surrender the only begotten Son. And we are there to give thanks. Thanksgiving is one of the great commands in the Bible. One of the great commands given in the Bible. Psalms number 82, verses 1 and 2. And there is a lot that is written concerning thanksgiving. During the Easter period, we give thanks because John 3:16, that for God so loved the world, he gave the only. That's what we read. We give thanks when we know about the genesis of our faith. Our God is a giving God, and it is one of his attributes. One thing that defines God, he is a giver. That all what I have, I've been given by him. Including my life, I've been given by him. Including the talents that you have, you've been given by him. Our God is a giving God. And when we give, I'm telling you, it is a portion of what he has given to us. We don't give entirely everything. We give just a portion. It's like when you talk about 10%. God's calculation is very fair. That if I give you one, if I give you 10, you just need to give me one. You are left with the bigger portion. It's the least portion. And I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, Thanksgiving ought to be our lifestyle. Thanksgiving is not a holiday, that it is one off. It should be embraced in our day-to-day life. But many a times, because of our tight schedule, our business and our schedule, many a times we don't take time to calculate and to count our blessings. He has done so much to us, we cannot tell it all. But when the opportunity avails itself, And as church, and the church put it in the calendar, even though it is a lifestyle and should be done regularly and all the time, there comes a time we tell you to pause for a while. Calculate and count your blessings and come and give thanks. That's where we are coming. Last week, this post Thanksgiving week is another week altogether, the week of Thanksgiving. Giving is a measure of how well we treasure our God in our day-to-day life. Allow me to remind you, praise and thanksgiving is one and the same thing. Praises that we bring through singing, the compliment that we make, praise and thanksgiving, they are interconnected. You cannot give praises to one that you are not thankful. You cannot make it. And you cannot make praises when you are crying. You make praises when you are jolly because you are like giving thanks for what he has done to you. It is interconnected. The one who praises God is thankful. The one who praises God. And we praise him and uplift him and put him to his right position for what he has done to us. And you know what happened? When you praise God, ukimuinua, umuinue, umuinue, itafika mahara, you bet. He had to come down, and when God bets towards you, that one means blessings. So it's upon you. Even the force of the gravity, ukinua kitu, inue kitu, it has to come down. Even our God, as we uplift him, there comes a time he also bade to bless you. God bending to you and towards you, that is translated to be blessings. So we have been called upon just to give thanks. Praises and compliment and admire him for what he has done to you. Brothers and sisters, this is our third year of COVID. Me and you, we are still around. We lost people, known and even unknown to us, and we are there. We are talking of another Easter. You people, you know, last year, we could not have any guts to come together because of what is happening. Today, there's some opening. Even though we are still not out of hook, God is still faithful to us. Enter his gate with thanksgiving and his court with the places for what he has done to you. Do you know God is the creator? And he created everything. But one thing that he never created is thanks to himself. He created everything. And everything that we see and touch and enjoy, and sometimes even call it to be ours, he created. But he never created thanks to himself. Like the way people put it, because you feel like you have done it. But what God did is what is written in Psalms 150, verse 6. Because God, he never created thanks to himself. What he created that every creature that has the breath has to praise him and to give thanks. Psalms 150, verse 6. And me and you, we are one among the creatures that he created. So thanksgiving ought to be part of us, and especially during this Easter. What he did to get his thanks is that he made a duty for all the creatures to appreciate him. So when you find, and I'm telling you, thanksgiving need not to be overstated. Thanksgiving should be like an unconscious reflex. You know, like now, if I want to uplift my hand here, I don't need to tell the hand, inuka. Ita inuka peke yake, ita inuka tu. Ikiwabia nini musimame, you just stand and find yourself standing because you have that ability. The Lord God, what He wanted from us is that thanksgiving become like unconscious. Though thanksgiving is so simple and straightforward, to some people, though thanksgiving is so simple, just give thanks and straightforward. But to some people, it's like an abstract positive. Equal, and I should give, but when it comes to giving, it's an uphill. I'm not ready to give. Yet, it's very simple. And you don't give thanks for nothing. You can quantify. And that's why we are being told, can you pause for a while? Because we have become 24/7 and we are busy. You are being told, can you pause for a while and count your blessings? Name one by one, and it will surprise you. Is that so? And it will surprise you what God has done to you. I'm there, I'm moving on, that thanksgiving ought not to be like a holiday. It ought to be part and parcel of me. It should be my lifestyle. I give thanks for the breath. I give thanks for my family. I give thanks where you earn a living. You give thanks even for a gift of a friend. Do you know the Bible says there is a friend who is more than a relative? A friend. Do you know your friend? Anyway, I'm asking a very obvious question. Very obvious. What value does that friend add to you? Who is that one friend that you cannot miss a whole day without talking or forwarding, even emoji? You know, you're going to me about emoji. You need to emoji your name. Your emoji. That they cannot go the entire day without. What value addition is that person? Do you give thanks because of that friend of yours for what he has contributed to your life? Thanksgiving cut across. And among all other friends is the one who died on my behalf so that I may be reconciled to my Maker. The gap came, and when I was declared and a curse put on me, a friend died for me so that I may be reconciled. What do I do to that friend? Our friend. What a friend we have in. There's a song. Yeah, what a friend we have in Jesus Christ. Everything to Him on a plate. Is that true? That friend. So Easter is a period and knowing clearly that thanksgiving, the key to multiplication is thanksgiving. Look at these disciples. They were in the middle of nowhere. And it is getting late. And the crowd was getting hungry. Because they were in the wilderness, in the middle of nowhere. There was nothing to eat. They were in a crusade with Jesus Christ. And it was getting late in the evening. And they needed to eat. And Jesus turned to the disciples and told them, feed them, give them to eat. In fact, to the disciples, it was a surprise. In the middle of nowhere, no grocery. Jesus, you must be a joker. You are telling us to feed the whole of this multitude? And I'm telling you, Jesus turned to one of the disciples called Philip. That's our second reading. Philip, can you feed these people? It is in the evening, middle of nowhere. Can you feed them? And they told Jesus, there's nothing. But one disciple said that he put a rider. It's only one boy here, only one boy. Do you want to tell me the entire multitude of 5,000? It's only the boy had a packed lunch? I see Michael in the cane. It's only a small boy. And I thank God for these children here. They are very honest. They said it's only, and they also put a right down as a disclaimer, but this one cannot be enough. It's only, but even it cannot rule it out. You know, there are people who know how to rule it out. You see, but Jesus told them, what do you have? But one disciple was carried in after it. It's ordinary. And they had it over. And I'm telling you, they told Jesus, what is this with this crowd? And do you know, allow me to tell you, according to the Jews, at the time they were calculating people, they were not calculating the women and the children. That was their behavior. So even when they were talking about 5,000, they were not calculating ladies and children. They were only talking about men. 5,000. That's for another day. So now here, as long in this story that we have read, John chapter 5, we have four characters. We have the multitude that was needy. Time has come for them to feed. There's nothing. There was the inadequate disciples, because when they were told to feed them, they said it is not enough. There is a little generous boy here who decided to surrender his lunch, and there is adequate savior here. There are four characters mentioned in that story. And we see here, they told Jesus it's only, and they even give even stepping behind. This is only, and they gave him. And as long as they were holding it, it was not enough. But we are being told by the scriptures, Jesus took the 5 loaves and 2 fish, and he gave thanks. And I'm telling you, the whole narrative changed. And he even challenged them, feed them, and he even told them, can you go and collect? And they brought how many baskets? There were 12. As long as they were holding and the lunch was with the boy, it was not enough. But we are being told, when Jesus Christ took them and offered a prayer of thanksgiving, the whole thing changed. The key to multiplication, thanksgiving, you know, key to multiplication, you should give thanks with the little that you have. First, give thanks. Christ Jesus uplifted it, and he prayed, and finally everything changed. Don't rule out the little that you have. Don't annihilate the little that you have. Just give thanks, and the narrative will change. Thanksgiving. And that's why here, brothers and sisters, during this time of Easter, even though your faith is like the mustard seed, this land is aligned with several trees and all the manner of trees, but have not seen the mustard. Mustard seed is the tiniest seed. And I'm telling you, one seed of the mustard seed, one seed, is the size of a particle of the tea leaves. Ladies, I'm here. You know the tea, ile chai, ukiweka majani yote, take one particle. That one particle is the size of the mustard seed. It's the tiniest. And we are being told it has the potential to grow to be a mighty tree. Let's appreciate the little that we have. Let's not despise our humble beginning. Let us give thanks. Call a meeting to yourself. Hey, there is what you are going through. Like Habakkuk. Habakkuk was a prophet. And Habakkuk is only 3 chapters. And before I talk about Habakkuk, ask your neighbor. We are still reading the book of Jeremiah, where our theme is, Buko Chaptagani. You know, our theme is in the book of Jeremiah. And I remember I gave an assignment. There are 52 chapters. Ask your neighbor, you're in which chapter? That's for another day. Habakkuk here is only 3 chapters. And during these 3 chapters, the first chapter, he is raising question to God because of what was going to the against the Israelites. They are being challenged by their enemies. And Habakkuk was not impressed with God. He seemed like he is silent. The heaven is silent. And in fact, if you read chapter 1 of the book of Habakkuk, he has raised over 6-8 questions. That's what he is raising. Directing them to God. And one of the 2 or 3 questions he's asking, why do you allow us to see the evil, wicked being done all the time? Number two, are you not from the everlasting to everlasting? Six questions, over eight questions he is raising in chapter one. And then when he was concluding chapter one, he said, and I'll sit down, I hear what you can tell me. I've told you. You know, Habakkuk raised the question to God, and then he called a meeting to himself and he said, now that I've raised all the questions, it's upon me now to sit, I hear what you can tell me. I'll sit somewhere, you tell me what you can tell me. And we see chapter two, God responded him. And on two, three that he was told by God, he was told, what I'm about to tell you, you Habakkuk, position yourself in a manner that you write with a big number, the big font, so that even a runner learning can see what I'm going to tell you. So you have asked me eight questions, and now you are positioning yourself to listen to my response. And he was told, you have raised the questions. Position yourself so that whatever I'm going to tell you, you are going to write with a big number, the big font, so that even a runner running can read and pick something. And then he was told, you are asking all this, but remember, the righteous shall live by their faith, not by anything else, not by their work. And that's where, after he was responded, he made a declaration that we have read. That is Habakkuk 3, verse 17 to the end. And now he is saying, I have listened to you, O Lord, even though the fig tree will not bear anything, even though the frog will die, and in the shade there is nothing, one thing that I will do, I will praise you, I will thank you, because I know who you are. It's a declaration. It's upon you. You raise a question, pause for an answer, and make a declaration. God is calling upon us. Do an audit to yourself. Evaluate yourself. We are in April. From April last year, how many people have gone to be the Lord? And I'm still around. You are still around like any other. Even though, I'll do this and this. I'll give thanks. Even though. Tell your neighbor, even though. The bereavement will come. We will lose our livelihood. Our business may not be performing, but even though, I'll remain thankful for the gift of life. I'll remain thankful. This is another Easter altogether. Even though, thanksgiving ought not to be overstated. As we go through this period, it's upon me to make my declaration for what God has done to me. Remember, and I conclude with this one, 1 Timothy 2:9, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Can you imagine also in the Bible, we are being referred to be the peculiar people that you should show the praise of him who has called you. You are not ordinary. You are not like any other at your level. And don't match your life like any other person. Don't talk like any other. Whatever you do, we are being told you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar person that you may declare of his faithfulness. May the Lord God keep us well as we enjoy our Easter, the Pasaka, Wakatua Pasaka. May the Lord God minister to us. I'm a tender maku. I cannot tell it all. That's what the singer is saying. How many people of your age? When I'm seated here and you're seated here, do you know there's some people who are in the mortuary? And you know how cold it is? Inside there. But for you are still enjoying. Even this afternoon, kuna mahali umepanga kuwa. Even sleeping and doing all other things. Let us be thankful. Kwa maana ametutendea. But the key, thanksgiving is key to multiplication. And our God is not in the business of addition. Can you imagine? Our God is not in the business of addition 1+1. Our God is in the business of multiplication. He is there to multiply. Can you imagine? 2 fish and 5 loaves. 5,000 people are faint. When you read the critical analysis of that, there were not 5,000. If the Jews, they don't calculate, they don't count the men, that congregation was very big, almost 10,000. And Jesus Christ did it. And as long as you are holding the little, it's not enough. Do you think when this meeting came to an end, and the disciples that were saying it's not enough, and they collected 12 after everybody was satisfied, in that congregation, who do you think that went home blessed and more uplifted than any other? Who? Among, remember the four characters. The four characters, we have the multitude. We have the inadequate disciples. We have a generous young boy. And we have our Savior, Jesus Christ, who was adequate. Among those people, who do you think that went home blessed? The generous little boy, what he surrendered. And he made even others people's lunch irrelevant. I'm telling you, he made them irrelevant. When I coach you with you, then you want to see the man who knock hang up with a packed lunch. Brother, it is the little that you have. It may be a blessing to you and even a blessing to other people. And it may be the avenue to bless other people. Release. Tell your neighbor, release. Release that little. Because I want to believe, without reading too much detail to it, even others they had there, even including these disciples, including the one who is saying, what is this? That they had it. And many are times. Can you pass it through your rain? Tikana na rain siya duwari yagi. Know your rain. The boy knew his lane and he surrendered. But even after surrendering, there's someone who is interfering with his lane. Know your route. Know your rain. Surrender the little. And as long as they were holding it, it was not enough. But what happened? When Christ Jesus received it and prayed, it became mighty. And the Lord God can challenge us in our game. What do you think about the disciples who were saying it's not enough? And after everybody faint, and he was told to correct that he came with one big basket holding it. Let us trust in the Lord. Don't shortchange yourself. Surrender the little. Remember this lady of the Syrophoenician. Remember the lady of the Syrophoenician. You remember? He was confronted by the man of God. And was told to give what she had. She said, only the little flour here. And only after we are done, we do what? We die. But you don't take anything. Uratuna tuko negera kama tugaaka, haki ya Mungu tuako negaaka, netuwa thira. And they were told, can you surrender? And after that one, you know what happened to the rich? Please give the rich through that man. Mind about obedience, the Lord will mind about your warfare. Give the rich. Ona mutumio wewe tuwa diagere ki, nyoku, kero ere nyoku akiona kero tukutatu nini. And she did it and did it openly. Please, release. Tell your neighbor once again, release. Tell whether I could go together, release. And it'll be a blessing to yourself and even to other people. Mighty God, we thank you, we exalt your holy name. Help us to keep hope alive and to be thankful. You created everything, but you never created thanks. Yourself. What you did, you created us and every creature that has a breath to give thanks to you. And we belong to that category. We thank you for Christ Jesus, though the only Son and the begotten came to this world that we may be saved. We are thankful, dear mighty God. Help us to embrace that spirit of thanksgiving, and you multiply the little, the much that we have. Hear us, dear mighty God, and you don't demand everything. You demand the least. Even when you are paying the tithe, you don't demand everything. You demand the least of what you have given to us. Much that you have done, much that we need to do, for this we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.